Our ethical religion has its basis in the effort to improve the world and ourselves morally. That the moral obligation remains in force is the capital fact to which we must hold fast, no matter what may be our theories of life and the universe. The recognition of this obligation, the hearty avowal of the supremacy of the moral end above all other ends of life, is the first article of a practical ethical creed. Now, I think we all know Curt Collier, our leader, who's going to talk to us today about how green is your war.
Well, good morning. How are y'all?
Good morning.
It's a great, beautiful day today. Yeah, it was a really, really great rally here. It was a lot of fun. And of course, it caps off a whole week long of activities. Actually, I wasn't in the march, but not. I was here the day before. And the next day, I was in Washington, D.C., down there working on a project to get more youth involved. And of course, they had scheduled their meeting on the same day. And so I had to do some traveling. So that's what I was doing. Good to see all of you, and I'm going to be introducing Nathan Hunter in a second, who I've worked with, one of my colleagues. So during this climate week, they were going over all these the things that are happening, and both the dire things that were happening, and the good things that were happening too, things that were reasons for us to at least to have a little bit of hope. And one of them, of course, was that Germany now receives almost 50% of its energy from renewable resources. Pretty amazing, the nation do that. Yes, so we're all applauding Germany. I wonder if we would have done that at least 60 years ago. And in fact, it's amazing to think about that story in a way. I mean, where Germany was and where Germany is now, and the leadership in many ways to help kind of save our planet and taking these bold moves. Actually, I heard that there's only one island now. Did you hear this in the news this morning? There's an island off the coast of Spain that now gets 100% energy dependent. The first island nation, or not even nation, part of Spain that could have done this. But what I want to do is to talk about what happened. I mean, it's interesting to think about Germany now, but I want to take you back a few years so that you all know quite well. And I'm going to give you an alternative history of Germany, and I'm going to give it from the eyes of environmentalists. Now, this is not to mean to reduce it to one thing that happened. The idea, though, is to explain in a way why things happened the way they did. As a humanist, I am less interested in what people think. I think that's fun and how people process and do things. I am very interested in what people do. That's why I draw the line. You know, interesting, we can have conversations and we can intellectualize, we can argue and debate, and those things are very interesting. But what people do is another thing altogether sometimes, and that's where I think I draw the line. So I'm going to ask Nathan to help me with this little projector here. I want your slideshow, my days in college. Here we go. Adjust this, adjust that. You're going to complain this is not working for a second. Just push the other arrow. As you can see, though, how much Europe,
takes a second sometimes. Push again hard. How much all these other nations had pretty much been organized and had existed for a long period of time. And for some historians, that is one of the reasons why places like Spain and France and England, and to a certain extent Belgium and Netherlands, had already gone off and colonialized the world. And where the Germans, what was the German possession prior to the 1800s? What was an Italian possession prior to the 1800s? Very good. That's Fuji, right? Yeah, the Christopher Columbus. We can say that, yes, but it didn't last very long. The land was quickly gobbled up by the Dutch in New York, the English in Virginia, the French, of course, up north. And so other people could come in and exploit those resources, let's go to, until the German unification. So Germany, of course, came so late that in the 1850s, what other earth-shattering thing had happened in the world in the 1850s? How had we changed? We stopped being agrarian and we became what?
Industrialized.
And so industrialization needed large amounts of natural resources, large amounts of that. And something then happened all across the world once again. The colonial powers, which had kind of controlled different parts of Africa, had waned in their control of those areas. But look at Africa in 1885. In 1870, before what was called the Scramble for Africa, in 1870s, 10% of Africa was controlled by foreign powers. By 1914, 90% of Africa was controlled by foreign powers. So the span of a very few part, almost every single one, a part of Africa, and of course South America was still controlled by other nations at this time, but almost all of Africa, of course, was controlled by colonial powers, by the powers of Europe. And of course, the latecomer to the table in many ways was Germany. They're going to eventually get what was then called Tanganyika and East Germany over there, and they're going to be a couple of little places over here, but they came in relatively late. And the reason why they went into Africa, of course, from environmentalists, is because of large amounts of natural resources and minerals, particularly cobalt, which you needed for steel, iron ore. I mean, Germany by this time had mined itself almost completely out. They were very small nations. They needed a large amount of resources, just like France and Germany, I mean, France and the United Kingdom and Britain. They needed to build a vast economy, and you needed natural resources to do that. And of course, they spread all through Africa and looking for those natural resources. Now, World War II was a completely different story, but similar along similar lines. So one of the biggest pushes, you think about where the Germans went. Now, they went into the Balkans, of course, because it was destabilized and they needed more land, and they thought that that was easy pickings because there were no other easy pickings around the world. They thought that that's the reason why, but it was. But what they really realized that they need is natural resources. So think about who was in North Africa trying to take over the oil wells on the German side?
Rommel.
Who was trying to stop him? Well, the British under
Montgomery
and the Americans under Patton, right? Remember Patton's tank commander as well as Penn's stuff. But basically what the Germans were trying to do was to get into the rich oil-producing areas of the Caucasus Mountains. You can see the Caucasus Mountain Range where there's lots of refineries and things like that today. It's not by accident that Crimea, that region that they're pushing into, and the Ukraine, of course, is still a big oil and gas producing area to this day, and they basically wanted to control that. And so, when you think about the history of wars, even in the recent years, without having to go way back in history, they've always, in a way, been about resources. In a way, they've always been tied up. We can talk about ideologies, we can talk about political philosophies, and they certainly play a role that I do not want to diminish. However, what we did in war was fighting over natural resources. Let me give you another example. If you go to the next one, where did Italy go? Look at Italy prior, go back. Yeah. There is Italy in, yeah, just go push it once and it takes a while. It's coming, it's like, thinks about it. If you think of Italy in 1870s, once again, until the 1871, also Italy got unified into one state. Prior to that, there were tremendously little savage wars all through Italy. They were basically fighting amongst the different duchies and for control of that. And the final one was, of course, the conquering of Naples all of these big battles that happened. And when it finally got its act together, where did it go? It needed natural resources. This is the 1870s. They're trying to build an economy. And of course, they went into Libya, what we called Abyssinia at the time, and what was called the time in Somaliland, because they moved into those areas, Somalia, just for the same exact reasons. If I showed you the map, they too went for natural resources. Their Italian expansion is one of the things, if you're running an industrial society, is you need resources. You need oil, you need fuel, you need gas, you need all these things that little tiny countries like Italy just don't possess. And finally, we can use another example of looking at Japan during the same period. Japan is an island nation, as you all know, formed by a series of volcanoes. They created the islands, but anytime you have volcanoes that come up and basically form islands, they obliterate whatever is underneath there, including the coal deposits, they deploy natural gas, any of those kinds of energy deposits were wiped out. So part of what the Japanese wanted to do, of course, is two things. Was they needed arable land for their burgeoning population. And so the first thing they did, of course, is they pushed up into Manchuria, basically to make that part of their land. But look also at this map showing you where the oil deposits are in China. They're in Manchuria. Where's the other place that you see in Asia? You see large amount of oil deposits. You see them, of course, in China. And you see them, of course, in Southeast Asia. It was too impossible to get in China, but they made incursions into there as much as they possibly could. And then, of course, they went into Southeast Asia, Indochina, and in Burma, trying to build roads and pipelines and things like that. Burma was destabilized, and there were other reasons why they went into Burma. But essentially, their expansion went in, just like the Europeans, into places where there are natural resources. So we've always created wars around natural resources. It's just kind of how we operate. We think the Americans, have the Americans ever done that? Let's go to the next slide. Let's look at the original flags of the U.S. Revolution, all right? These are the original flags about the American colonists and the American Revolution. In fact, this is the first flag ever of New England, all right? This is the flag that flew over Bunker Hill. There seems to be a central motif to these flags. What is it? Trees. Why trees in 1770s? Wood was the commodity of the world. There was no oil, there was no natural gas. What you needed was wood. You needed wood because, think of in the 1770s, what had they invented that needed large amounts of wood? Huh? Not steam. That doesn't come until the 1830s. Sailing ships. You need large amounts of sailing ships, right? This is a wood economy. When Columbus sailed across the Atlantic, he had a mast with a piece of cloth, and he waited basically for the wind to blow him across the Atlantic Ocean. That's what he did. That's why it took months. By the time we get to the 1770s, people had figured, don't get blown by the wind, sail into the wind with clipper ships. And those clipper ships got bigger and bigger and bigger. I mean, the Spanish fleet could fit in this room. They were pretty small. If you see reconstructions of them, they were the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria could have easily fit in this room. It's amazing to think about that. Yet the clipper ships were starting to get larger and larger and larger. Just go down to Chelsea Seaport Village, and you can see that. So wood was important. And when the English finally figured that, when they could no longer go through the Dutch and the Swedes to get to Vilnius and Latvia to get the large groves of forest there, they turned to, of course, their other place, their other commodity, which is the United States, America, because of the vast forest. That's what we had. We had billions of acres of big, massive timber. Think of that. If you had seen a white pine back in the day, before we cut every single one of them down, they've come back, but now they're nowhere near. They were bigger than many of the redwoods. Imagine forests of white pine that looked that big. Imagine seeing all these tulip trees that you see all over the Northeast, these perfectly straight poles that go on forever. And why would you need a super tall straight pole? A mast. And some people think the reason why the British lost the war is because we stopped giving them timber for mass. And anytime you try and fuse together two Brit logs with a band around it, like you see in these kind of movies, that doesn't hold the strength of these really, really fast, heavy moving ships, and they snap and break, and those good stuff. So the English kind of knew that. They knew that from the beginning. They really went into all of New England, and they said, listen, these forests belong to us, and here's what we're going to have. And so for the colonists, it wasn't about taxes. It wasn't about anything else. The first thing that pissed us off was about trees. And that is really what fueled us, the whole notion of liberty trees. The other thing, of course, is you think about U.S. westward expansion. Now, this is a map of the arable land in the United States, which means land where you can grow lots of foods and vegetables. Where's the most, where in this map do you see the greatest concentrations of arable land, land that you can really farm? Where's it look really dense?
Middle.
Am I right here? Now, looking around New York, looking around Massachusetts, Connecticut, do you see much arable land there? That's the problem we have up Northeast. I mean, I work in developing urban farming and really trying to push. The problem is we have very thin soils in the New York region. Any own places up north or lived up north, you know the topsoil is about that thick. Whereas if you go out west, the topsoils used to be, you know, 18 feet deep. It's no longer that. We destroyed that. But it's now down at least to 6 feet, and we still have plenty of things in there. So if you think about where did the U.S. start to expand first, they could have gone, of course, into Appalachia, but there was nothing there. The mountains are too rocky. If any of you have been to Appalachia anywhere, you know that that's not good farmland. And so there was the Cumberland Gap, and beyond that was massive amounts of land, beautiful arable land with lots of water and nice and flat and loaded with Native Americans, right? And if you think about everything that we have done about that since that day, the beginning of our end was about that, was the grab for natural pieces of land. We weren't pushing into Maine. We weren't pushing into New Mexico and everything else. The Spanish were operating down here in Laredo, Texas. I'm from here. This is Laredo. They were down there since the 1400s. They were sitting in Texas, right? But nobody wanted that land because look at the arable land. And of course, where did we go? If you look at westward expansion, there was the Northwest Territories, because that was the northwest part of the United States at that time. We pushed into that area. We pushed into the south. Of course, the French still controlled this until 1830. And of course, the only thing we didn't have is this piece of land right here. Why was that unorganized? It looks like a nice arable piece of land right there. In fact, can you go back, just push it once and see what happens? 1001, 1002, 1003. Push it again. I'm gonna run real quick. Look at this. Great piece of land. That's gone. Go back. So, 1001, 1002. So you see a nice piece of arable land. Try and go over one more time. This is a really, really good place for westward expansion. The problem with that land is, there we go. And look at the forests that covered the United States in the 1620s. I mean, 50% of the United States covered by forests. Forest was our economy. We were a nation loaded with wealth, and the wealth was wood because people didn't need steel, they didn't need those kind of stuff. 1850s, all of the forested areas up and down the East Coast. Look at Connecticut, not really one forest left. I've seen pictures of Connecticut from the 1850s, not a tree anywhere. Which is really, really wild to think about such a green place. And look at this massive mounds of wood right in here. The problem was, who was there? Look at, by the way, look at the forest in the 1920s in the United States. We went from 50% coverage down to 9% one time. Make sure that, go back, I'm so sorry. Okay, I'll answer my question. Who was here in the 1850s? Native Americans. So, it's starting in the 1830s, actually, we started, of course, this thing called the Trail of Tears, basically taking all the Creek, the Choctaw, the Chickasaw that were located on this land and moving them to Oklahoma, to western Oklahoma,
off their lands so that we could have access to all their farms. And of course, that has been our story for many years. In fact, the only place, I'm sorry, go back.
I'm eager.
Yeah, it takes a while, right? The only thing that we had then, of course, was giant force. This part, of course, was still controlled by Britain. Who owned this part down here? Not Spain at this time. Yeah, Mexico, right? So the war with Mexico was ensued. The war, we made treaties with Britain. We gave them British Columbia. We divided this, we divided what was then Oregon into Washington, into Oregon, and we kicked the heck out of Mexico, seized large amounts of their land, and a policy known as Manifest Destiny. It's a very educated crowd. You just give them a letter and they know what it is. And we read there, if you look at where we went and why we went to those places because of the forts that were located up there. You can see why the Louisiana Purchase, when that occurred, why Louisiana didn't mind selling this big single tract of land. Did you ever wonder why they sold this area of land? What's not there? The forest, they didn't think there was any value to that they didn't need to go to. So this was Vermont in the 1850s. As you see, it's completely denuded of forest. You think of one of the greenest states, the green state, and the greenest state in our area by the 1850s. And of course, if you look at old photos, all of New England and the first stuff, there were almost no trees left. This is the same view today and how we restored that. One of the things that stopped us, of course, is by the 1920s, we were starting to run out of wood in the United States. How did most Americans heat their home until the 1930s? Outside of New York City? No, never even heard of it. I bought a house in Yonkers, New York, went downstairs and said, someone dumped a bunch of rocks down here. I didn't know people burned coal. I had never seen anyone burning coal. Most Americans, other than Appalachia, have never seen anybody burn coal. We burn wood. Majority of Americans, even to the 1930s, most of America heated its home by wood. It's amazing to think of that. Even to the 1940s, 50%, almost 50% of America still heated their home by wood outside of New York City, the big industrial areas. Right? Most Americans weren't living in cities back then. They were living out there, and we needed the wood. Luckily, in 1901, down in near Beaumont, Texas, a little place called Spindletop blew up. It was an oil well, and they found one of the largest gas and oil wells in the entire world located in Texas. Within, by the 1930s and 40s, we were switching from gas lights in the city, which diminished in most of America, not to like a, y'all remember seeing gas street lights as a kid? They were still around, think about that. We were still lighting with gas, which is a major way of lighting with gas, even when you were kids. But then oil replaced all of that, and of course has led to another other problems as well. We still, of course, have a number of conflicts which are about resources and the fight over resources, and mostly, of course, the West's complicity in what's happening in Baghdad. You look at all the companies, you can see a who's who of the types of people who were involved, even to this day. This is a recent map. These are the people who got the signed negotiated settlements on who's going to be able to work and pump the oil. And, of course, we have American or Western now with all these multinational interests in Iraq. Why is there so much unrest in the Belgian Congo? What do they have?
Uranium, cobalt.
They have minerals that we need for this. Without those minerals, what are called conflict minerals, we can't power many of our cell phones. You see the cell phone explosion around the world, and where do you see conflict as a result of that? In the Belgian Congo, right? Because these are some of the largest areas of exactly the minerals. Look at Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, and Belgium, formerly Belgian Congo, Democratic Republic of Congo. If you think of the wars and the conflicts that come out, you go, why are they having such a vicious, horrible, disgusting, murderous war in that area? Just turn next time you pick up your cell phone and go, oh, that's why, because I have a cell phone. Right? Because we have to have cell phones. Nokia is one of the few companies, and I don't have a Nokia phone because I tried to buy them in the United States and couldn't find them, which is a non-conflict phone, mineral phone. You can buy conflict mineral phones, free phones. And look at Texas now, my native state, of course. This is when you're flying over Texas, that's all you see for miles and miles and miles and miles, flying into South Texas
And of course, they're extracting lots of minerals, and of course, and all that, their oil wells, and that's all you see. You fly west, you want to see these weird, looks like roads to nowhere. Those are all about oil and gas. That's all it is, gas exploration. Now, let's take other conflicts around the world, other than the Belgian Congo. Take Ukraine. Ukraine has some of the largest gas reserves in the entire planet. They don't need Russian oil. They don't need Russian gas. They don't need any of those things. They have plenty. In fact, their reserves are bigger than the U.S., they're bigger than Brazil's, and they're bigger than China. They have tons of gas and natural resources. So why are they so tied to the Russia and all these kinds of problems? And you can look at who are the most efficient. So Germans are the most efficient nation that we have in the use of natural resources. One of the biggest wasters is Ukraine, right here. In fact, here's the most oil-producing nations, and who uses the most energy, of course, China. Russia, the United States, and of course, India, the big economies of the world, and Ukraine. How many of you think of Ukraine as one of the biggest economies in the world? So why are they using so much natural resources? Because they're so doggone inefficient in their house, their construction, their cars, their buildings. They are the biggest wasters of natural gas in Europe. And in a way, those conflicts, even in Ukraine, could be solved if the people just did a fraction of what they do in nearby Slovakia or Czech or Republic, any of those nations, or even Poland. Just do anything different than what they're doing about energy conservation, and they won't even need this huge conflict with the Soviet Union. Moving on. So what are the conflicts in the future going to be about? They're not going to be about oil, they're not going to be about gas. We've already reached peak production. We can't produce as enough as the demand is. The demand far exceeds that. It's going to be about water. Water is the other thing, of course, that we're fighting about. And this is the problem that we're going to have living in the next, in our present time. I would imagine we're in the 1920s in a way of thinking about that. Here come the 30s and the 40s with their tumultuous time last century. I hope they're not the same way, but we're sure headed that way. And I think a lot of that has to do with look at where conflict areas are around the world and look at who is missing water. And water is going to be what everybody thinks is going to be the wars of the next century are going to be about, because there's very little water to begin with in some places, or very little economic development to help get that water out in other places. And so it is going to be the next looming crisis that we have. Climatologists have looked at predictions of where they think rainfall is going to come, where it's going to go. Some of us, like in New England, are going to get plenty of rain, get used to it. You're going to see a lot more rain and snow and heavy snowpacks, things like that. Whereas other part of the world, they're just going to continue to get drier and drier and drier and run out of water as this period goes, exactly in the areas where we think many of the conflicts raging on to this day. And for many environmentalists, those conflicts we are not about Islamic jihadists, it's not about even oil anymore, it's about grabs for water. If you look at the water table, where the world's underwater resources are, right? So we have only a tiny fraction, right? What percentage of the Earth's drinkable water is accessible to us today? What percentage of fresh water do we have today? 1%, very good. That's right, 1% of the water, world's water is drinkable and we have access to it. A lot of it is either frozen in ice caps, stored in the ground, or salt water, and it'd be too expensive and too difficult to convert that into fresh water. And if we look at where the underground water supplies are, Africa, especially South Africa, looks in pretty good shape, right? Central America still looks like it's in pretty good shape. The United States, of course, is already stressing the Ogallala and Ouachita aquifers in the center part of the United States. Why are they losing so much water? You think it's from agriculture? What are they drawing out massive amounts of underground water for now? Fracking. Stick it back underground in a polluted form. What a dumb idea that was. But look also across here. All of these underground aquifers are just going away quite a bit. And it's going to be about water in all those places for a long time to come, because not only is it not available on the surface, it's not available underground as well. So here's an interesting question. Does economic stability help the environment, Or does stabilizing the environment lead to economic and political stability, and by that we mean peace? Which comes first? Do we raise enough people economically and that'll stabilize the environment? Or do you fix their environment and you think that's going to lead to economic and political stability? It's a very interesting question. And a lot of people are thinking, we've always thought that what leads to peace in Europe, of course, was the social security net, right? I'm going to die in Europe somewhere, because then you're taking care of the rest of your life. You know, you don't make it in the United States. You know, it's the survival of the fittest in many ways here. We have a little bit better social security net, but in other places they don't. Look at this map of the difference between totally destabilized Haiti on one side of the border and the Dominican Republic on the other. And one of the things you see, of course, is the number of trees. Haiti, of course, is one of the poorest nations in the entire world. It has a tremendous poor economic structure. They've gone through many, many problems and conflicts one after the other. Let's see if this is going to happen. Here's a view of the island of Hispaniola. We can see, of course, the DR on this side, this gorgeous green lush piece. How many people have been to the DR? A few of y'all? And here's Haiti over here. Look at the amount of deforestation that happened to have. This island looked exactly the same. And by the way, this photo is older, and I've seen more pictures now that show it's worse and worse. And of course, one of the reasons why deforestation is happening in Haiti is because people are what? This is the argument. Because people are poor. They're poor. And because they're poor, they're cutting down trees for fuel and for firewood and all this good stuff. And they're cutting them down, of course, to grow food and things like that. There are really good reasons why they're doing that. But they're deforesting the whole island and all this good stuff. And so people think, well, what we need to do to fix this is just to bring more industry. If we can attract more industry and manufacture to Haiti, just like they do in China, we can pay people a low amount of money. They're not making anything anyway. We can give them money. They can have a nice job, standard of living rises. That's what we need to do to just fix this mess. The problem is, for a lot of environmentalists, is that's not going to happen. But one of the reasons why manufacturing takes large amounts of water. Look at how much each of these nations waters in manufacturing. The United States is not the manufacturing powerhouse that it used to be, but we're still a big manufacturing powerhouse, and almost 50% of our water goes to manufacturing and industry in the United States. Nearly 50% goes to those regions. We're not drinking it, we're using it in machines, we're using it in factory. Look at China, right? You know, almost 70% of their water is now going to manufacturing. Their water table is dropping like mad. You see all these problems that are happening over and over again, of course. It's dropping like mad. But look at India. 85% of their water now is used for manufacturing things like that because they don't have the same kind of water supplies that they have in Southeast Asia. That's the other reason. So if you're using all this amount of water, you take large amounts of water to make manufacturing. So we wonder if just manufacturing and raising up the economics through that is going to solve the problems if it leads to things like we're having in China. China is running out of water. China is rapidly depleting its water resources. They polluted the Yangtze. Everything else is a big, huge mess. There's very little drinking water left. They're importing some drinking water in a lot of the big cities. And their reliance on coal is actually skyrocketing because they're a hungry nation for energy. They need energy for manufacturing. And they're putting their coal mines exactly in the areas that already see coal water stress. These are the areas that are hardest hit with water, and that's exactly where their biggest stands of coal and coal-fired power plants are located. This is a looming crisis for China. They're well aware of it. Now, let's see, Germany went after natural resources, Italy went after natural resources, Japan went after natural resources, America goes after natural resources, the West goes after natural resources. Have you heard that China has gone around the world looking for natural resources? You're darn too. Will that ever lead to destabilization in the future? Probably in some ways that we have yet to see. Hopefully they're not going to do what we do, but we know. We know that the Chinese population has grown slightly. Of course, it will continue to grow at pace with the rest of the world. But their industry use of water is skyrocketing, and there isn't that much water in China. And this is going to lead to them doing, just like all of us have done throughout time, kind of a very, very similar process. So the question for me as an environmentalist, as an ethicist, what should I be doing? right? That's the question. I could go to companies, countries, and I can fight for people's hearts and minds. I can debate Islamic jihadists. I can argue over democracy. I can do all these kinds of things, and I wonder how far I get. I can go in and I can build factories. I can get people jobs. I can raise up the economy. But if it's in an area that's going to lead to further destabilization because of the environmental damage that happens to that, that may be a short-term goal, but it's just going to destabilize in the future. So we have to think about other things. I brought actually with me Nathan Hunter today. Nathan Hunter is graduate of Manhattan College. He was a marketing and environmental studies major at Manhattan College. He started their Green Club there, and I met him because they were building a rooftop garden at Manhattan College because of this young man wanted to bring urban agriculture to the area, and he partnered with Groundwork, and we came up there and helped them build their beds and keep them going. He also then eventually interned at Groundwork Hudson Valley, the organization I work with, and then, of course, has just spent a year working in Tanzania, and I'm going to let him tell you about that.
It's really a pleasure to be here today. I actually had a connection with the Society for Ethical Culture in Riverdale. Since I went to Manhattan College, I used to volunteer at their men's shelter. And that was some of the best days. John Benefati was a really great guy, and I got to know everyone there. So Curt led the introduction. I just got back from Tanzania. I was based in Tanzania for about 5-6 months, and then I did a bit of touring for the remainder of my time in Africa. But while I was in Tanzania, I did research. That was my main purpose. I ended up meeting a professor who's actually from America. He's from California. He was doing some really interesting research. Two projects in particular caught my interest, and I helped him out with them. The first of which was in regard to agriculture. So I was doing research based on commercial insecticides versus local alternatives, such as neem, because neem trees are everywhere. So that was the first project, agriculture, and then the second was alternative cook stoves. So what I focused on was gasifying cook stoves, which I'll talk more about in a moment. But I'm really just going to give you a little brush over of my experience in Tanzania and kind of the things I saw and could see conflicts coming about or had heard of conflicts that came about. But I completely agree with Curt in the idea that these larger issues, these what seem like geopolitical issues, stem from natural resource deficiencies. So we can start. So this is just like an overview. Some of the major issues that come about because of natural resource deficiencies are severe drought and lack of water, deforestation, food insecurity, natural disasters, all that. Let me give you some context about where I was living in Tanzania. I forgot to do that a second ago. So in Tanzania, you have microclimates, you have such different areas, and it's in East Africa where it's typically known as a wet climate. But where I was living in Dodoma. Dodoma is the capital of Tanzania. It used to be Dar es Salaam, but then it moved over to the center of the country. They chose it in one of the worst locations because there's very little water. There is an underground water aquifer, but when you look at the surface, it's basically just a semi-arid desert. It's not a desert, semi-arid. So lack of water is an issue. So about 4 or 5 months of the year, you get heavy rainfall. And then for the remainder of the year, it's bone dry. So it's incredible because you have green, you know, lush, and then within a month, it's all gone. It's really quite sad. So we can start with the next slide, which has to do with water. So water management, I mean, Kurt covered a lot of it, but water in Dodoma specifically is a concern. So most of the people in Dodoma are subsistence farmers, and they rely on just rainfall. So I was shocked by this because I thought, oh, well, you know, it's modern times, you know, they're going to have hoses or something. But they use no real government assistance of, you know, for water. So what you find is you have these rivers. So this picture is called a sand dam. But it's a river. It's just your standard river. This is the dry season, though, or it's actually probably been about a month or two after the last rain. But essentially, this is naturally filled with water, you know, during the rainy season, and then it dries up. Now, organizations, one in particular, built this dam. It's called a sand dam. And it collects sand, so as it rains, the sand travels down, and it gets stuck behind a wall. Now, that sand, between the little particles, has room for water, capturing water. And so, what people do in the dry season is they just dig a hole and just pick up water from the sand. So it's a really great way to divert or to get around the water issue. So that's just a really good resolution. And then energy, it really is like the center of all problems, it seems, because we are such like a energy dependent, now that we're, you know, industrial, energy dependent. And that goes the same in developing countries as well. Besides cell phones, which they're on top of, everyone has at least two cell phones. It's incredible. It's really quite incredible. Besides that, just basic, you know, energy use. So cooking and you know, just very limited. And that is in the form of charcoal, as you see. So you have these gigantic stacks of charcoal. Now, these people, they go up into the hills and they cut down trees, essentially, and they dig these pits and they put the timber in the pits and then they light it on fire and they cover it with sand so it burns down into charcoal. And then they sell this at the markets. Now, it's unfortunate because in Dodoma especially, there's very few trees because it's so dry and because of deforestation, such as from the production of charcoal specifically. But you're seeing things change, and that's, if you go to the next slide, this is the project I worked on. It was called gasifying cook stoves. So essentially, we take biomass, so waste from agricultural, you know, production, and we grind it up into a powder, like a sawdust, and we create these pellets. And when you put them in a chamber, and you ignite the top of the layer of the pellets, and what happens is that heats up the chamber and releases natural gas. And so all natural things have gas in it, like a type of, not methane, but a type of natural gas. And when it's all heated up, it releases. And so a clean flame is lit because the gases go up to the top and light. And that's really great because one of the number one killers in Africa is actually indoor air pollution. And that's from cooking with charcoal. It's disgusting. It's really quite heartbreaking to see these women bending over and cooking all day in charcoal-filled rooms. It's just like terrible. So that was a project I worked on. But you get a nice clean flame, as you can see. It's a gas grill. Here's your air gas burner. Now, when you go up into the hill, so this is a hill that was right by, you can see this from the school I was working at in Dodoma. It's called Radio Hill. But you look at it, this is a dry land forest. It's not like your typical rainforest or anything like that. But you see these patches like here, there, and that looks really good. Like that's the forest isn't suffering as much as it could. It could be, but you have essentially these slash and burn areas that are used for agricultural production. So besides people taking the timber for charcoal production, you have people who are subsistence farmers, and their land, they've used up all the nutrients in the soil, so they've abandoned those pieces of property and are now heading towards the hills where it hasn't been cultivated, it's been natural, so it's got nutrients. Now, what happens is, when you do this kind of system, the land is good for maybe two seasons, and then you have to move on again. You're using up the soil nutrients. And in this region especially, in general Africa, they don't have glaciated soils. It's all very old. It's basically clay and sand. So that was very interesting to learn about and have to deal with versus, you know, from Connecticut, we have this beautiful, in many areas, nice, rich soil. So you see that it's quite a problem. Now, back on that other slide, you saw those pellets. When you burn the gasifying cook stoves, when you burn the pellets, you conserve a lot of the carbon because it turns into charcoal, and you're able to put that charcoal back into your farm. And so what you do is first of all, you're eliminating deforestation, but you're able to get a secondary product to put in your farm. To increase the life. Because when you put charcoal in the soil, biochar is a really popular product these days in the garden centers and stuff like that. Charcoal holds and creates a nice environment for bacteria that is, you know, creates this great synergy with plant roots and allows nutrients to stay in the soil, which in Africa, that's a big issue. Is you, if you're not by the volcanoes, you lose all the nutrients, you don't have that. So, you can continue. So this is actually a photo of Rwanda. So I had a chance to go out to Rwanda for a few weeks and talk to a couple businesses that were doing this biomass gasifying coke stoves. But Rwanda has a huge issue. It's known as like the land of 10,000 hills. If anyone's been there, it's a beautiful place, but it's all hills and then valleys, you know, it's because it's a part of the mountain, Virunga volcanoes, the gorillas, all of that area, that's Rwanda. So what people do, because they're all subsistence farmers, is they grow food on the hills. Now, I'm sure a lot of you know the problem with that. You have issues of erosion, and with erosion come nutrient loss. And then once the topsoil is gone, because of erosion, what do? And then you have issues, greater issues, natural disasters like mudslides and landslides, and it just becomes a problem. So you have the problems that I mentioned before when you deforestation, you take away the trees for charcoal, you're taking away for agriculture, and then you're removing the soil. So you're left with no resources. So you find people are in a bind. So they become desperate, which is really, really, really sad to see that. What's the next slide? And then that's actually like my last slide. But something I was thinking about while I was kind of putting this together, has anyone seen the movie Captain Phillips? It's with Tom Hanks. It's a great movie. He's a hostage by Somalian pirates. He's on the big barge, and his barge is taken over by like three skinny, scrawny, really sad looking Somalian pirates. And at one point in the movie, spoiler, Tom Hanks asked the pirates, "Why are you doing this to me? Like, why did you take my boat hostage, and why are you like torturing me? And you're fishermen, why aren't you fishing?" And they say to him, "We can't fish. Companies came in and took all our fish." And that, like, there was a moment of, like, severe empathy. Like, I was just like, oh my gosh. Like, that's what it is. That's the problem. It's, like, this resource conflict. I think that movie, like, I was thinking about it. I think that line in that movie sums up what Curt is trying to say. And what this talk is about is, like, you have companies especially, but you have other interests, you know, be it way back in time, you know, historically, colonialism, come in, take resources, and leave people severely impoverished, and not with dollar bill, you know, like impoverished financially, but with resources. There's a complete, people are deprived, so that it's robbery. And so you see that all over Africa in many different ways, but yeah, so if you know, when resources are managed properly, you will have, you know, all these great things, food security, you won't be struggling because the soil will have a long life, you know, lifespan, and people can create a life from that. My host mother, all she wanted was to have her own piece of property so she could have fruit trees, chickens, and a vegetable garden. From that, she said she could sustain her whole life because she could sell the fruit off the mango trees. She could grow vegetables like cabbage and stuff that, the Chinese cabbage where you snip and it just grows right back, stuff like that. So she can create a business from just a piece of property and sustain it for the long term. And that's essentially, if you look on a larger scale, that's the earth. Like if you keep it going, it'll keep going, and everyone will be wealthy in a way. So that's my experience.
So I'm flying to Chicago with any kind of luck, because they had a fire there, to speak for the EPA on this big rail trail I'm building on from the Bronx to downtown with groundwork. That's about a lot of good people working on that project. And so I'm doing this presentation, and one of the people I'm taking with me is a young man who was with me in Yellowstone National Park. And I think I told y'all this story for those who were at the climate march, is that we were working in Yellowstone, and one of the things we do is we work all day long, we're doing projects and stuff, and the evenings we go on hikes. And one of the things we went is Bunsen Peak. We're in Mammoth Hot Springs. I got to spend a month living next to this thing and went hiking. It was really fun. I'm climbing to the top with all these kids, and we really pushed them, and they're going, "How much further?" I'm going, "It's about half the distance to the ball." So, you know, it's like they're all walking along, we're pushing and pushing, we're getting closer and closer to the top of the mountain. And finally, they could see the peak, and I told some of the kids, "Go ahead and sprint ahead." They're running for the top of the mountain. And we finally got up there, and I'm waiting, and I'm encouraging the other kids, "Come on, you're almost to the top of this. I know it's hard. Come on, you're almost there." And finally, this one kid comes up from Richmond, Virginia, and he looks around at us, and he goes, "I can't believe I made it up here." He says, "I thought I had lived until I went hiking up here." was a really, really nice thing. He said, yeah, very, very exciting. And then one of the other kids turned to me and said, yeah, everybody should have a right to see something so beautiful in their life. And then I thought, yeah, I hope so. Thank you very much.